Camille Paglia is the University Professor of Humanities and Media Studies at the University of the Arts in Philadelphia, where she has taught since 1984. She received her BA from the State University of New York at Binghamton in 1968, and her Master's in Philosophy and PhD degrees from Yale University in 1971 and 1974, respectively. Her prior books are Sexual Personae, Art and Decadence from Nefertiti to Emily Dickinson, which came out in 1990, Sex, Art, and American Culture, Vamps and Tramps, New Essays, which came out in 1994, The Birds, a Study of Alfred Hitchcock, published in 1998 by the British Film Institute, Break, Blow, Burn, Camille Paglia reads 43 of the world's best poems, and Glittering Images, a book she was here last year with 5 years ago, Glittering Images, A Journey Through Art from Egypt to Star Wars. She's here this evening with her seventh book, Free Women, Free Men, Sex, Gender, Feminism, a selection of her most notable articles and lectures on these subjects. Her third general essay collection will be out a year from this fall from Pantheon, the publisher that's been publishing her work since Sexual Personae. Professor Paglia was co-founding contributor and columnist for Salon.com, beginning with his debut issue in 1995. She's written numerous articles on art, literature, popular culture, feminism, religion, or education, and politics for publications around the world. It's a pleasure to thank you all for being here tonight, and now please join in welcoming back to Seattle, Camille Paglia.
Well, hello. I don't know which mic to use first here. It's what a pleasure to be back in this beautiful city. The first time I came for a book tour here, I think, was 1992, and it's just always a thrill to come back to Seattle. So this is my seventh book, and I had hoped it was going to be my third essay collection, because it's been since 1994 since my second one was published. I've written so many things all over the world. I think many important pieces on religion and history, culture, and so on. But my publisher felt that my pieces on sex, gender, and feminism have been so prophetic for the last 25 and 30 years that it was urgent to get them out now. So we went forward with this book, and it's absolutely amazing how almost like a tsunami, events in the culture swept forward, and things I wrote in my introduction to this book last summer, when I wrote the introduction, seemed to speak directly to this moment. Now, my premier principles as a person and as a thinker are free thought and free speech. I am truly a child of the 1960s in that respect. And I am totally opposed to any kind of curtailment of either of those two things for whatever laudable social causes anyone may think that they have. My particular influences came from my experience in the mid-1960s in college. When I entered college in 1964, in the fall, that spring had happened. The free speech movement at Berkeley. Mario Savio is an enormous culture hero to me. In college, my influences were heavily the beat poets who created the great scandal, City Lights Bookshop in 1957, the obscenity trial, the arrest of the manager of City Lights Bookstore for selling an obscene poem. Allen Ginsberg's Howl, Kaddish. These were huge influences on me in college. Same thing, Lenny Bruce. Okay, Lenny Bruce, who is the person who transformed the medium of comedy, stand-up comedy, from merely gags in the vaudeville style to satiric, acerbic, but meaningful style of analysis of social problems. Lenny Bruce is the one who made comedy politically and socially relevant. And Lenny Bruce was an equal opportunity offender. He went against both liberal and conservative shibboleths. Right? And then the first thinker really who had enormous impact on me in adolescence was Oscar Wilde by chance in a secondhand bookstore in Syracuse, upstate New York. I stumbled on a copy of a book it was a British book called The Epigrams of Oscar Wilde, and it actually is still available from the Dover editions. They thought, presumably, that no one in the U.S. would recognize the word epigram, so they call it now The Wit and Humor of Oscar Wilde. But it has many of his wonderful one-liners from his plays, from his writings, from his dinner table conversation in London, organized by topic, you know, nature, men and women, et cetera, et cetera. Oh, this scathing, uncompromising quality of Oscar Wilde's thinking, huge impact on me. And then in college, this was before the Stonewall Rebellion, before the gay liberation movement, gay men were absolutely scathing, going against every possible social convention. They would say things that would make you wince, like about polio victims and so on, all right? Now, what happened to that, okay? After Stonewall, gay men have become increasingly either recreational, again, hedonistic, okay, or they have become very PC and politicized, all right? And so all of a sudden, they're part of the army for the control of speech, right? But I think, underground gay men are still just as bitchy as ever, I'm happy to say, right? But then in college and graduate school, I began to read also the influences on Oscar Wilde himself, which would be Baudelaire and the Marquis de Sade, okay, who was imprisoned for the way he defied convention, etc. It wasn't that long before I was in college that there was the great trial for obscenity in England about Lady Chatterley's lover, Penguin Books. It was brought up on charges of obscenity, and when Penguin Books triumphed, it was a great blow, against the forces of censorship. So that's what I have stood for, right? And my particular wing of feminism was suppressed for many years. My feminism predates second wave feminism, which was created by Betty Friedan with her co-founding of NOW in 1966. I was already a feminist because I was directly impacted by first wave feminism in the early 1960s. When I was 14 years old, I suddenly became obsessed with Amelia Earhart after an article about yet another clue was found, whatever it was, that was in the Syracuse Herald Journal. And I embarked on a 3-year research project in high school into Amelia Earhart. I went to all kinds of places. I ransacked the old newspapers and in the bowels of the Syracuse Library and so on. And also, I was obsessed with Katharine Hepburn, who I saw on late night TV. What I was getting from Katharine Hepburn, I did not realize for decades, was actually the real flame of first wave feminism, because her mother was the head of the Connecticut women's suffrage organization. Her aunt was also a campaigner for women's suffrage, and Hepburn herself campaigned as a small child with balloons and at protests, votes for women, votes for women, etc. So I was getting this first impact of 1920s, 1930s, after women had just won the right to vote in 1920. We wanted to reproduce in my new book the actual page from Newsweek magazine in 1963, the letters to the editor, where I was given the lead letter to the editor when the Soviets launched Valentina Tereshkova into space. She was the first woman to enter space at a time when women were banned from the American space program. And I wrote a protest letter. I was 16 years old. This is before NOW, was ever founded. I said that this happened. She went into space on the very anniversary, 35th anniversary, whatever it was, of Amelia Earhart flying the Atlantic. And I said it's obvious that Miss Earhart's quest for equal opportunity for American women still remains to be won. Okay. All right. So I was already a feminist, before all this happened in the late 1960s. Then I tried to join the women's movement. It did not succeed, because the women's movement had all kinds of preconceptions about the suppression of speech, they were anti-rock and roll, anti-art, go down the line, one of the what we later would call pro-sex feminists. Right? So, in the 1970s, for example, I loved Charlie's Angels. okay? I loved Cosmopolitan magazine. I loved Scavullo's covers. I mean, meanwhile, the other feminists were like occupying Helen Gurley Brown's offices and like wanting the whole magazine to be shut down, et cetera, right? I loved the Bond girls, James Bond girls, or Ursula Andress coming out of the water with her white bikini, okay? And like, you know, she's the conch, you know, with her knife, et cetera, right? So I love the Dallas Cowboy cheerleaders. There's no way I could be taken into the women's movement. I was drummed right out of it, right from the start. Okay, so people who say, oh, she was made by feminists. What do you think? I was not made, okay, by Betty Friedan. As I say in the book, Betty Friedan did not create Germaine Greer in Australia, and she did not create me in upstate New York, okay? All right, and it's about time people realize the transformations in women that happened very radically in the mid-20th century are not entirely due to the women's movement. I show in the introduction to this book, how many things preceded, okay, the creation of N.O.W. Okay, I mean, Diana Rigg, okay, in the Avengers was in a black leather catsuit, okay, before N.O.W. Okay, doing all that stuff. Okay, Betty Friedan didn't create her either. Okay, so anyway, okay, all right, I don't want to get sidetracked on that. The whole thing will turn into that. All right, now wait, let me. I only have a certain amount of time here. All right, so let me. Well, let me see. So what happened was Madonna. Okay, Madonna was so important. I mean, the way Madonna is behaving now—it's such an embarrassment. All right, because the current Madonna bears no resemblance to the pioneering Madonna of the 1980s and 90s. But she will live forever for what she did. Okay? The pro-sex feminist movement of the 1990s was made possible by Madonna's trifling with pornography and exposure of the body and so on, and her brilliant videos of the 80s and 90s. I believe they are truly works of art. Okay? Her great period was 1983 to 1992. And I periodically do show some of those videos, like Vogue and Open Your Heart and so on. And these are truly works of art. Okay? So at any rate, it's all of a sudden this long silenced wing of feminism, the pro-sex wing, burst forth, okay, in the 1990s. There was Feminists for Free Expression, for example, that I was allied with. I appeared in an event within the early 1990s and so on. What we were fighting against was the horrible scourge of political correctness and suppression of free thought and free speech during the 1980s in the anti-porn movement led by Catherine MacKinnon and Andrea Dworkin, okay, the fanatics. Okay? So I include in this book, okay, what I think is my classic attack on them. Okay? I call them the birth of Carrie Nation, and those women, they wrote an ordinance which was indeed adopted by Minneapolis and Indianapolis to shut down even the sale of men's magazines in those towns, like known as Playboy and Penthouse and so on the grounds that supposedly pornography caused violence against women, caused rape, caused murder, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, these women were deranged, okay, truly deranged women, but they ruled the 1980s in feminism. So then, thanks to Madonna, my pro-sex wing of feminism rose up. Okay, right, and also was helped along by the lipstick lesbians of San Francisco. There was like a cell of them, okay, sort of black leather, lesbians and so on. Right? So then we went national, and I thought, oh, now we've won, okay, there's no problem. Okay, so I kind of retired from the scene in 1994 after being like out there with fisticuffs for a number of years. And then I went back to what I do. I wrote books on the movies, okay, Alfred Hitchcock's The Birds. I wrote a book on poetry, a book on the visual arts, and right now, I've been for 9 years. I've been involved researching Native American culture of the Northeast. That's what I'm doing. But I have to go back on the road. Okay. 23 years later, I have to return, okay? All of a sudden, we've gone full circle again, okay? And this horrible scourge, of political correctness is back, even worse, okay? We have people rioting and smashing windows at Berkeley, okay? The place, the capital, okay, of the free speech movement and so on, okay? So here I am again, okay? I am not happy about it, okay? I'd rather be doing my Native American research, okay? All right. So now, a number of things. First of all, what I'm calling for, the title of my book, okay, which is okay, Free Women, Free Men, I'm calling for an end to the sex war, okay, in feminism. Okay. Women are well launched now, okay, so this kind of, this reflex, snide, you know, put downs of men that are everywhere, this has got to stop. Right. Now, I notice, you know, wherever I go in the world, actually, that upper middle class career women are very unhappy. They're very unhappy, okay, even though they have achieved a certain status. What I'm saying is feminists have to stop blaming men for their own unhappiness. The unhappiness is due, I believe, to huge systemic changes that women, for thousands of years, women had their own world. There was the world of women, and there was the world of men. And the sexes didn't have that much to do with each other, okay? This is a brand new experiment to have this new system where now women can be economically independent now. They're no longer dependent on father or husband or brother, okay, for their sustenance, right? And they're working side by side with men in the workplace, right? This is an experiment. It's never happened before, right? I'm saying in the book that we may have to accept a certain amount of tension between the sexes in the workplace. Right? The feminist idea that if we can just suppress men enough, women will be happy. I say no. Okay? I say, okay, and it's on the basis of my own experience as a child in Italian-American immigrant community, okay, is that what women have lost is the old solidarity that they once had when they totally ruled the private sphere. The women's life all day long was with other women once, multi-generational, older women, okay, as well as the children, right? It was a huge tribal experience. And now what women are feeling is a sense of isolation and loneliness, disconnection, okay, from their old function. I'm not saying to go back. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying stop blaming men, all right? Like, for example, these marches that just happened, okay? The women were exhilarated. They were almost hysterical, okay? I don't think it had anything to do with feminism or anti-Trump or anything like that. I thought it was that women suddenly felt that surge of happiness again for being with other women, all right? All right? You can actually see it in the Odyssey when Odysseus is washed up naked and alone, he's lost his ship, you know, on the shores of Phaeacia, and he wakes to the sound of girls, women's voices laughing and singing and so on. It's the princess Nausicaa going down to do the laundry on the shore. Okay, and actually that is exactly what was going on up until fairly recently, where women were all together. They did all the chores together. They did the laundry. They did the cooking. I mean, I can remember this from my childhood in Endicott, New York, upstate New York, among the immigrants. Italian women. All four of my grandparents, plus my mother, were born in Italy. And so I actually had that experience, the experience that went on for thousands of years in the agrarian era. Well, women all together. In fact, my mother described as a small child in Italy how all the women would get together to do the laundry and go up the hill to Il Sorgo, which was a fountain cut out of the side of the mountain, probably went back thousands of years to the Roman period and so on. She remembered the singing, you know, the picnicking, et cetera, okay? So even though people were laboring physically in the agrarian era, there was a happiness, okay, a sense of identity. There was no quest for identity. Now, it's no place for an independent thinker, okay? If you were an independent thinker, you had no options as a woman except to become a nun, okay? So I know, okay? I know I would have been a nun, okay, 100 years ago. All right, I know it, okay? And obviously, you know, communities are intellectually repressive in their own way. Nevertheless, we're in a period now of quest for identity, tremendous pressures on young people to form their own identity separate from those old automatic tribal and community affiliations. So I think there's a tremendous, as a classroom teacher, you know, of now, you know, more than 40 years, I can see this, and it's really, there's a tremendous sense of psychological dislocation among young people, and they find many ways to try to achieve some sorts of identity. And part of it right now, of course, is social media, which is causing the total, you know, entropy in terms of ability to reason, to read, to write, you know, the old things. And so on. All right. Now, I'm also calling for an end to this insanity of excluding biology, okay, from gender studies. Now, how in the world did this happen, all right? How did women's studies and gender studies end up teaching about gender without any reference whatever to biology or to hormones, right? And right now, post-structuralism dominates gender studies everywhere. Now, I spent 6 months writing my dissection of Foucault, okay, what is that, 27 years ago. Now, assignment, hello, anyone who thinks that Foucault is somehow, the master of the universe has clearly not read my exposure of him in Junk Bonds and Corporate Raiders, all right? I mean, the man was a fraud. I'm sorry, okay? Compared to Freud, okay? I mean, Freud is out and Foucault is in, all right? The post-structuralists, all right, pose as leftists, okay? But what were they doing in the past few decades with this crazy parasitic growth of this administrator master class, okay, that has taken over the universities, right, at a period of obscene, okay, rise in tuition costs, student debt that's crippling families and so on? Where were these leftists, the great leftists, okay, on our college campuses, okay? Were they resisting the administrators, okay? Were they denouncing student debts, okay? Were they lamenting, the plight of adjunct teachers and so on? No. They were all running to conferences, talking about Foucault with their stupid elitist jargon, okay? And you think they thought that's leftism, okay? These post-structuralists are the worst mercenary careerists, okay, in this country, right? The leading post-structuralists, okay, and new historicists are retiring as multimillionaires. And they pose as leftists, okay? It is a scandal. Forget Foucault, for heaven's sakes. I mean, it's absolutely absurd, okay? So we have to bring biology, an authentic study of medicine, of anthropology, of history, back into gender studies. That's one thing I'm definitely calling for. Now, aside from these things, okay, there are a number. I'm on the warpath against, okay, the bureaucracy of the campuses. Okay, when at Bennington College, my first job in the 1970s, 1976, we had an uprising, okay, as faculty against the trustees and the administrators, the president of that college, and it was like huge, publicized. Nora Ephron went up there and wrote it up for Esquire magazine and so on. And the faculties are totally castrated. What are they doing? The faculties have absolutely been marginalized in this country. And they didn't utter a peep as this administrative masterclass took over. The administrators who are in league with federal mandates or federal authorities in Washington. I mean, we're living in an age of Stalinism right now. Okay, and again, the leftists have they talk a big talk. Okay, but they do nothing where it really matters, okay, which is demand 50% reduction in the number of administrators, okay, and also 75% reduction in their salaries, okay, which often exceeds that of the faculty members. People should realize how many of the ills that I'm decrying about the suppression of speech and free thought on campus are coming from the administrators, okay, who are these social welfare do-gooders. Oscar Wilde, okay, was absolutely scathing about these humanitarians, these aggressive philanthropists who dominated the Victorian period. All right. At any rate, in terms of other things in the book, there is a reprint of what I consider an important piece of mine in Time magazine, where I called for the end of this outrageous age 21 law in the United States, where young people cannot buy a beer. Okay, nowhere in the world except in very repressive regimes, right? Like the United Arab Emirates and so on. Is there anything like that? Okay, what mothers against drunk driving, okay? They wandered into an area here that has been extremely destructive. When that rule was passed in 1984, okay, what did young people do, unable now to drink, okay? They began taking the club drugs, of course, okay? Ecstasy and ketamine and all this crap that they take into their bodies, right? And what's happened to the ability, of young people to go to a bar, learn how to drink in a sensible way in an adult context, be able to sit with the opposite sex? learn how to talk, how to flirt, discuss ideas, okay? It has absolutely a cruel law. No one has raised, I mean, you can buy marijuana in Colorado, right? And young people can't get a glass of beer, okay, when they arrive in college. Do you realize how outrageous that is? Now, why aren't you more outraged, okay? That has to end, all right. So just to return to what I was saying about the solidarity of women in the agrarian period, I think that probably part of my ability to analyze things comes from my exposure to almost a kind of a capsule, condensed version of human history. I experienced the agrarian era through my contact with those powerful country women who had immigrated, and there's a whole piece in my book about Southern women, okay, about the power of the rural paradigm and the strength of Southern women and so on. But we were, a whole town of us, really, from Italy, concentrated in this area of the Triple Cities in upstate New York because of the shoe factories, the Endicott & Johnson shoe factories. So I then had a direct experience of the industrial era, which followed the agrarian era, that when my grandfather, everyone in the town, went to the factories, which dominated Endicott with the smokestacks in that period before environmental laws. The soot would be heavy, you know, on windowsills. You could smell the tanning pools and so on. So I had the experience of the industrial era. And then my father, fresh out of the paratroopers in World War II, was able to go to college on the GI Bill. I was born while he was in college. My parents married at 20 and had me at 21. So he was like mopping the cafeteria floor, the only member of his large family to go to college. Then he became a high school teacher and then a professor at Le Moyne College in Syracuse. So we moved into the new surface sector, you know, economy. Right. So I, in my own life, I've experienced all these transitions in human history. So I think it's given me a kind of insight into change. Now, what I'm saying in the book is that those women, the country women, okay, were more powerful, okay, than any feminist. Okay, they were physically powerful, literally, in that period before automatic washers and dryers. Everyone did laundry by hand. I can remember my grandmother washing on the back porch with a washboard, okay? They were powerful like this, all right? And these women had big voices, okay, and big attitudes. Right? So, I mean, in fact, once when my father was teaching high school in the small farming town of Oxford, New York, we lived for a year in the upper floor of a farmhouse, and there was like a hilarious moment. My father was out with his brother. They were standing outside smoking a cigarette, and suddenly the farm woman yelled at them. Okay, a calf had escaped from the barn, and she said, "Stop her!" Okay, to my father and my uncle, and the calf thundered by. My father and my uncle just stepped backwards as it went by, and the farm woman went, chased the calf, and came back carrying the calf. Right, and as she's passed them, she said, "Men." Okay. Those were the women. For thousands of years, you know, country women had physical power and mental power, and they were the equals of men. In fact, it's no coincidence that the first states and territories to give women the right to vote were in the West. Okay, that it was the pioneer areas. Okay, where it was obvious that women were the equals of men. Whereas it right to the very end, the educated states, the states where the great universities were, like Pennsylvania, New York State, Massachusetts and so on, refused to grant women the right to vote, not until the constitutional amendment was passed in 1920. It's because the differential between the upper middle class man and upper middle class woman, okay, in the late 19th century and early 20th century was very profound. Okay, the lady, a lady, seemed to be a different entity, seemed to be far more emotional, tended to faint, you know, tended to be rather delicate, etc. All right, so the idea of granting such women, however admirable, you know, the right to vote, was not as easy as it was for the territories. You want me to? Okay, maybe. Okay, why don't we just move to the question period then? Because I love the question period, and I'm sure you would too.
Hi.
Hi.
Thank you. I didn't know this talk was happening until just recently, so I'm really happy I stayed, and thank you for coming. Oftentimes in discussions I'm having with people who I've gone to school with and friends of mine, oftentimes over Facebook where things quickly get lost and, you know, no nuance exists there and everything, oftentimes it feels like the best thing that I as a cisgendered male can do is to die. And I realize that now, hearing you talk and everything, that this is kind of the result of the pendulum being swung very far to one end, and I was wondering if you thought that are we now at the point where a pendulum is about to swing back into a more kind of moderate, let's all actually do something together and treat each other as equals, all genders, all races kind of thing?
Well, I'm calling for men to take control again of their own lives, right? I've said in a recent interview that if there's a women's center at Yale University, which there is for the undergraduates, then there should be a men's center. There should be absolute equality. And the men should be totally free to do whatever they want in their men's center. Right? They can show dirty movies or whatever they want. Okay? This constantly beating down of men, okay, this demand that men redefine themselves until they suit what feminists want them to be, it's an outrage, right? And I'm saying throughout this book and the pieces I've written over the years, you know, that the civilization, with all of its protections and conveniences, is essentially the invention of men. Now, I explain that in my first book, Sexual Personae, by saying that woman's power is so enormous that men had to band together to go off and to create these objective structures. And I still think that my analysis of it is absolutely right. But it's men who are doing all of the, you know, the hardest and dirtiest work in society. I told in a recent, you know, interview of there's a whole list of things. Okay? When there's an ice storm, okay, in the Northeast, it's the men who go out at 2 a.m. with the fall, the live wires and so on. I rarely see women, okay, going out at that hour. I never see women manning the great vats of tar in the heat of the summer that people are mixing to put on the roof, okay? I never see the women last year, saw an enormous sewage break in a neighboring town with where men in hazmat suits were up to their knees in wastewater, okay? Not a single woman wants to volunteer for that kind of work. People are still depending on men and keeping working class men invisible. I've launched an attack, for example, on Sheryl Sandberg, right, as incredibly smugly entitled, talking about, you know, leaning in while at the same time concealing from sight all of those servants that she has and the nannies that she has, okay, who are you know, working class people who are supporting her particular very public lifestyle. I think in general, it's men are erased, the contributions of men are erased, and also the contributions of working class people are erased to, and this has to stop, okay, it has to stop. We need a much more enlightened feminism. I think that most men are in favor of women rising in society and being in charge in society. We're no longer in the antediluvian old days. So I want men, okay, to recover a sense of who they are as men again, okay, and not feel they have to obey any list, okay, checklist being issued by Gloria Steinem and company in Manhattan. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hello.
Hi.
So a lot of what you're saying is very, very offensive and bothersome to me as a cisgendered man living in the year 2017 in this city. And to your point about the ice storms in the Northeast and how women aren't out there fighting them, well, why don't you think about, like, these institutions that like road crews and the, like, microaggressions and the sexism on these crews of the working class man. I'm a landscaper, and I can tell you that there is a huge degree of, like... Okay, my question is about, do you believe that sexism is relevant? Because you said that women have to stop blaming men for their unhappiness, and nowhere in there was a discussion of sexism in the workplace. that women are like treated as less smart, as less capable. And it seems to me that your words are sort of reinforcing this notion, especially in terms of the like workplace.
Well, I am an equity feminist. That is, I believe in the removal of all advances to women's, all obstacles to women's advance in society in the professional and political realm. So absolutely, I'm very focused on any instance of workplace sexism. What I'm saying in my writing is that we are not simply what working individuals, right? There is a public side of our life and there is a private side of our life. In Sexual Personae, you know, 700-page book, I talked about the psychological, you know, the dream life of mankind. There are all kinds of primitive impulses in us that are very atavistic. Do we want to understand ourselves as human beings or what? Okay, we cannot simply define human beings in terms of what we are in the workplace or in the political realm. I believe that was actually the biggest legacy of the 1960s. 1960s were about turning away from materialistic careerism and embarking on a kind of cosmic quest for meaning in the universe. So I think that my work offers a kind of dual perspective. I'm talking about women's advance in society and what best helps that, and I'm also talking about our need as human beings to expand our imaginations. I have, even though I'm an atheist, I have a very spiritualistic view of the universe, and that is my particular vibration with Native American culture. That's in fact what I'm doing for the last 9 years, is trying to map, okay, the actual metaphysical religious perspective of the ancient Native Americans. I believe that my views of things as represented in Sexual Personae are very much in vibe with that.
Hey, Camille, thanks for coming. Sure. I haven't read any of your books, but I've seen your videos, so I'm a fan. Anyway, I can't remember which video it was, but you were talking about college education, and you're fed up with the whole cafeteria style, I think you called it, the invent your own major. You think
yes.
You should go back to a survey sort of, and I graduated from college several months ago, so I've never taken a survey course in my life, so I was hoping you could talk about what you think the benefit to that type of education would be.
Yes, I think that's been an absolute disaster what's happened in the last 30 years. I'm speaking, as a career college teacher, which is this degeneration into the cafeteria menu, where young people arrive in college and say, you can take this or this or this or this or this or this, and then you have all these like kind of narrow courses being offered by professors who are basically teaching what they're interested in. I think that is not education at all. Okay, that the best kind of education gives the broad view. Okay? The abandonment of the great art history survey course has been a cultural disaster in this country, where it used to be you had two semesters, you would begin with cave art, the Stone Age, and move all the way down by the end of the second semester to abstract expressionism and modernism. Right? This gives a sense of the narrative of history. But of course, in postmodernism and poststructuralism, all narratives are false. Okay, everything, please. Okay, there is a narrative in history. There is. Okay, you know, I've talked about how the pillar forms, created by Imhotep at the pyramid complex at Saqqara, in Egypt, that can be seen 5,000 years later, in our Corinthian columns and banks all over the United States and Europe and so on. People who deal with artifacts of archaeology and history, can recognize the legacy and the continuity in cultural traditions. So I think that colleges need to be very stripped down. They need to be making decisions about how to about what they're going to teach. Now, I have been saying for 25 years that for me the best multiculturalism would be to teach comparative religion, the world religions, right, as a way to introduce students to the world, not just to the Western tradition, to the entire world. And if my plan had been followed, we wouldn't have a lot of the problems today in incomprehension about Islam. People would already know about the sacred texts, okay, and would be able to discuss discuss, okay, that this group, okay, is following these particular verses of the Quran, this group is doing that, and it wouldn't be this chaos which we have right now. And this period of secular humanism is an absolute failure, okay? Young people, okay, are starved for meaning. That's why they're clinging to politics. But you cannot cling to politics. Politics and the social realm, this is minor. It's a minor part of human existence. Okay, there's something much bigger, okay? Much, much bigger, the universe. Okay? There are whole wells of deep meaning out there beyond the political realm. I'm not saying not to demand social reform. I'm not saying, you know, to cease to be progressive and to look for the most just human society possible. But I am saying that there is a kind of mania abroad right now, a total obsession, okay, with politics. This is a betrayal of the legacy of the 60s, a betrayal of the tremendous vision, the cosmic vision of the 1960s. And I've written about this. I believe that the reason for that is that the apostles of that particular spiritual quest of the 60s are lost to us because they took so much LSD, they never came back. That's the problem. They never wrote the books, which should have been the companion books to my own work. Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, thank you for coming.
Thank you.
I read Sexual Persona during a time when I was recovering from an incident with sexism. And so workplace sexism definitely is something that affects a lot of women. What can male allies do to help alleviate the common situation of workplace sexism in a way that doesn't overly blame them for the problem?
Well, I'm saying that a real man is honorable. A real man respects women, right? And that any man who abuses women or treats them in a denigrating fashion is showing weakness, a weakness that in fact comes from some inner sense that he has of woman's overwhelming power, right? And to prove that, I had to write a 700-page book, okay? All right? So I'm calling for a mutual recognition, a mutual respect between the sexes, but I'm also calling for middle-class girls to stop asking for special protections. Again, I want equality of treatment in the workplace, but I think there's too much decrying, okay, of men's behavior, when in fact what too many white upper middle class girls are bringing now, okay, to the workplace is a certain manner of speaking, okay, that is removed from the actual harshness of the world. That actually working class women, whether they come from the farmland or they come from the street, okay, understand the risks and dangers of the world. So some of the most controversial writing that I've done is about the need, okay, for women to be Amazon warriors for themselves. Okay, that is my philosophy is street smart feminism, okay, or Amazonism. That's why I pose with weapons in so many of my pictures. All right, it's up to women themselves to understand the dangers of the world, not expect the world to be an extension of their protected, comfortable middle class living room. And that's, I think, what's happened. I see women whose voices aren't strong enough. Okay, women have to learn, okay, not to be embarrassed. Okay, to be loud. Okay, and to confront when it happens. Okay? I see too many cases of women who are dismayed by something which they feel is demeaning, and who just accept it. All right, and that is not no. No, the first time it happens, you speak out. You speak out, you stop it. You're in their face, like immediately, you see? Okay, and that's what I believe I represent, okay? Which is that every moment of every day, you have a responsibility to protect your own dignity, okay? And it doesn't matter if you're embarrassed or you create an embarrassing situation. You protect yourself. Now, you see, when my generation arrived in college in 1964, the parietal rules were in full, in full power. So that at Harper College, State University of New York at Binghamton, where I went to college, the girls had to sign in at 11 o'clock at night into the dorms. and the guys could run free all night long, okay? And so it's my generation of women who said, right, we want this, the same treatment as men, we want the equality, okay, that, you know, and freedom that men enjoy. And the you know, the colleges said, no, the world is dangerous, okay, we must protect you. We must protect you against rape. And we said, give us the freedom to risk rape. Freedom. Freedom is the value, not protection. Okay? So it dismays me to see young women today wanting the parent figures back, okay? Wanting the oversight, wanting to run to committees when something goes wrong on a date. I oppose that, okay? I think it's infantilizing, and women have got to stop doing that, okay? They have to govern their own relationships with men or with anyone else, okay? And that is the only way women will ever become totally free and totally equal.
Thank you for that.
Thank you.
You just mentioned, you compared the agrarian period with the physical effort of that era that created strength in women and men, and then going into the modern era where people became more fragile. Mm-hmm. Do you think that modern society with technology is sustainable? Because constantly we are removing all of our stresses and all of our efforts from the environment.
Yes, I am concerned. Yes, first of all, the technology today has become our art form. There's no doubt, okay, that you know, that the constant modulations and evolution, okay, of our handheld devices and so on, it's the equivalent of art forms in another society. But I am very concerned about our excessive dependency on this new virtual reality. Now, I love the web. I was in the, you know, from the founding issue of Salon magazine. I've been part of it, et cetera. But I'm very concerned because I see a pattern from ancient history, which is that when you have empires which become extremely affluent and extremely complicated, you get very complex bureaucratic structures, and everything gets so interwoven that it's very easy for the whole thing to collapse. You know, and at the same time, you get an affluent, educated class that's extremely tolerant. Okay, that is rather hedonistic, that has no scruples about heterosexuality, homosexuality, and so on. Anything goes, et cetera. They're in the ancient Roman period, they're vacationing on Capri and in Pompeii, and so on. All right, so I am concerned, okay, that we're heading toward a civilization that is so complex and so dependent on other people, and particularly on electric power. All it will take, okay, is one gigantic asteroid burst, okay, that takes down the power grid, and all of a sudden, mankind is going to be scrabbling back to the primitive and barbaric realm again. So I do feel some concern about the fragility of our culture and our removal from nature, our removal, you know, and with secular humanism has also gone this cosmic vision I was talking about, right, and the lack of this larger perspective. So yes, I mean, I don't, I think there's reason, you know, I feel shadows coming, yes, okay.
You see no exit from this cycle?
Well, my theory of history is cyclic. I believe I see a kind of organic pattern in history as in artistic styles. Things begin and, you know, great ideas, high energy, it grows to a certain point, and then you start to get the decadence. Now, I love decadence, okay, all right? I mean, Oscar Wilde was, after all, my very first influence. But I feel like I'm a decadent at the fall of Imperial Rome. That's why I'm very interested in androgyny. That's been my subject, you know, since I was in college, the subject of my dissertation. I consider myself transgender, okay, and I think people are starting to understand that my book, Sexual Personae, was a transgender book, okay, that it was a transgender protest against the power of nature. Finally, I think people are starting to wake up to that. Okay.
very nice to see another Southern Tier native and Binghamton grad.
I'm sorry, I didn't.
I said it's very nice to see another Southern Tier native.
Oh, you're a Southern
and Binghamton
Tier.
Grad.
Oh, okay. Oh, great. Okay.
We have a common upbringing, and our fathers knew each other.
Oh.
And you're very big on extended family, clan, and tribe.
Mm-hmm.
What sort of paradigm would you see for making this relevant in the 21st century?
Well, I'm not sure that we could ever recover that tribal, connectedness any longer. But I do see it still surviving for working class families much more than for upper middle class families. I noticed this, for example, when going to the New Jersey shore just to walk on the beach and so on. I see in those working class resorts of like the Wildwoods, right, how often you have multi-generations of families vacationing together. Okay, it makes me quite nostalgic. That is something that's completely gone from the upper middle class. The more affluent you are, the less likely it is that you're going to go vacation with your parents, okay, where people run off to expensive resorts in the Caribbean and so on. They're not taking, you know, the grandparents with them, right? But working class families in Fairmont Park, in Philadelphia, you know, every week you can see immigrant families still, African-American families. They'll come for a day in the park with the food, toys, football, et cetera. They'll take some park benches, the barbecue pits, and so on. Spend the whole day there, multiple generations of a family all together for the day at the park. And every time I see that, it takes me all the way back to Endicott and to what, you know, what I remember that's lost now, okay, which is that this everyone knowing each other, the people who came from the same town in Italy, and the people would grow up next to each other. People didn't move. Today we're in a very transient culture where people, to get a job, will go hundreds of miles, thousands of miles, far from the extended family. So what you have today, it's a great difficulty for women trying to manage a household, okay, in also a job at the same time. The simultaneous is the collapse of the old extended family into the nuclear family. Now, what I'm saying in my work is that I think the nuclear family is toxic. This is something new, and this is what conservatives, you know, my argument with conservatives, who constantly talk about, you know, the need for a two-parent family and so on. I'm going, throughout most of human history, okay, there has never been a two-parent family. Okay, it has been a multi-generational family has raised, the children, right? Not just two. So I believe that what we have today in America so often is like these houses lined up next to each other with you know, two-parent family and the children. These actually are kind of toxic cubicles for neurosis, okay? I don't necessarily think that has ever been, a healthy prescription for children to be raised. And another thing is that at first, the women benefited enormously from the invention of all these labor-saving appliances, like the automatic, washer and dryer and so on, right? This saves women so much time compared to all the laborious doing of the laundry and rinsing out the, squeezing the water out and so on. But now today, the laundry, which used to be a communal activity with other women, has turned into an isolated, lonely thing, for women. Okay, you're trapped in a house to do the laundry, okay, et cetera. And also, the higher up you rise in affluence, the less likely it is that you know the neighbors. Okay, you don't know the neighbors, all right? And even if you know the neighbors, you would never dream of saying to them, oh, something's come up. Can you just watch, my two or three children? Okay, well, I just run. You would never do that in a million years, okay, in an affluent neighborhood. Whereas in a working class neighborhood, people know each other, they trust each other. And also, people in working class neighborhoods, particularly in cities like South Philadelphia, are oriented toward the street. They're watching, they're sitting on the stoop, they're sitting on the porch. okay? So there's this sense of a neighborhood that's it's like a real community of the old days. So again, I think that as people move up the economic scale in terms of affluence and power in the workplace, they're actually getting more and more neurotic, okay, all right, because of the psychological dislocations that have not been, I think, you know, fully confronted. So I don't know exactly how to recover these things, but I do think that it's useful for women to realize, okay, how much they've lost in terms of their solidarity with other women.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here. I hope you'll forgive me, but I'm pretty obsessed with politics.
I am too. I follow it constantly. Yes. Yeah.
I would love to hear your thoughts on the forces that allowed the rise of Mr. Trump, especially in the media.
Well, I mean, I'm a Democrat. I supported Bernie Sanders. I voted eventually for the second time for Jill Stein of the Green Party and so on. I view the victory of Trump as a response to the failures of the Democratic Party to confront real problems. There are longstanding problems in the United States that the Democrats had no solutions to. All right. I felt this coming, you know, for a very long time. I thought it was a terrible mistake to allow the DNC to push Hillary Clinton through as the nominee. I'm sorry, it's my opinion. All right. And I don't think that, and I quite frankly, I wish that there had been younger candidates in both parties. I think it's about time for my generation, the baby boomers, you know, to get off the stage, for heaven's sakes. I wanted nominees for both parties to be younger people in their 40s or early 50s, and I don't know how it happened, okay, that we ended up with so many, you know, older nominees. So I think that, I hope there's going to be a great blast of energy into the political system soon, okay, but it's important for my party, for the Democrats, to do, seems to me, a very clear-eyed analysis of the reasons for the loss, because there were real issues about job creation and other things. Reduction of the federal bureaucracy, okay, was an issue the Democrats were helpless with. Okay, I think that bureaucracy is, to me, an octopus, a parasite, whether it's in Washington or it's on the college campuses. Bureaucrats, are automatons. Okay, they are absolutely soulless. Okay? The minute you allow any entity to be run by bureaucrats, okay, we're in trouble. Okay, and so the Democrats just want to add on and add on and add on. Okay, this is not the way. I don't call that progressive. Okay, progressive is to deconstruct the bureaucracy. So again, Democrats have to come up with better solutions to problems, and they'll start winning again.
Thank you.
Okay, sure.
I would just like to ask you to talk some about the differences between men and women that you think are really important, whether they're hardwired or have developed over thousands of years, mm-hmm. in feeling, in thinking, in sex drive, in workplace, whatever you want to say about that.
Well, I analyze this at length in Sexual Personae. Yes, I speak about biological factors and the way the mind works. It's slightly satirical in chapter one of Sexual Personae, but I think I'm right, which is that boys have to learn, because of their genital anatomy, how to aim. Right. If they don't learn how to aim, okay, when they try to urinate, okay, they will soil themselves and the wall and everything else. Okay, they must learn to aim. Okay, and eventually that carries over into the sex act. All right, and so I talk about that, the focus and purposiveness and directedness. Okay, and how, you know, Freud. It talks about how primitive man preened himself on his ability to put out a fire, okay, with a stream of urine, okay. And I say, well, that's a strange thing to be proud of, but beyond the scope of any woman, all right, who would scorch her hams in the process of trying to put out a fire with a stream of urine, all right. So I do believe, okay, that there are sexual differences. I think that that as civilizations evolve, as they become more complicated, that gender eventually has a performance quality, that it becomes an artifact, like other artifacts, like works of art. I mean, that's why I have a 700-page book on this subject, my first book. But that ultimately there are very fundamental sexual differences that come from the fact that most men have 8 to 10 times the amount of testosterone in their bodies than women do, right? And that, I mean, for my entire life I've noticed the way men talk and think is different. I mean, heterosexual men talk and think different than the way women think. I remember my father saying he could that when he would listen to the women talking, my mother, my aunt, and you know all of it. He said he could never follow the conversation. No names were being used, and sentences weren't being ended. Okay, but yet everyone knew exactly what they were talking about. Okay, and I've noticed that myself. People will say, and that's why I love the Real Housewives. Okay, it's I adore the Real Housewives. Gloria Steinem hates it. Okay, you see, but the Real Housewives absolutely records and documents the way women are in a group. Okay, now maybe not dissenting women, maybe not lesbian women. Okay, I'm just talking about heterosexual women. Okay, all right, in a group, I love to be around heterosexual women talking in a group. Okay, and so do a lot of gay men. That's why they're stylists and so on and so forth. Okay, there's like a weird energy, okay, that the women have with each other. Okay, it goes all the way back to the hunter-gatherer era, okay, where the women were all talking with each other around the hut while the men went off in the hunting party and had to be quiet and silent while they stalked the prey. You see, the talkative men didn't last long, okay? Okay? Et cetera. All right? But you know, at the same time, I do feel that that transgender people and that many gay men occupy kind of middle ground between the sexes, right? And a tremendous amount of the history of the arts, okay, it was created in that middle ground, okay, that transgender shamans had a vision of the universe, had an intuitive quality, but biologically speaking, every single cell of the human body, the DNA has a DNA code in it, which tells you what the actual gender of that body is. So that I think that there's a lot of talk these days about the ability to change sex, but you cannot change sex in point of fact. You can make modifications of the body. You can take hormones that further change the appearance of the body. But ultimately, at a certain point, every single cell in the human body will continue to show that it is either male or female, except for a very tiny number of truly intersex people. And now, I don't know what I exactly belong to. I've never for a day in my life have I felt female. Never for a minute in my life have I felt female. But I don't feel like a man either. Okay, so I'm willing to acknowledge that I have a gender dysphoria. Okay, and out of that gender dysphoria, I made a lot of books. Okay. My books are my sex change. I've said that Sexual Persona is the biggest sex change in history, okay? And in fact, the truest thing ever said about Sexual Persona was by this gay intellectual guy in Massachusetts who ran the Gay and Lesbian Review back in the 90s. He said, the voice of Sexual Persona is the voice of Myra Breckinridge. Now, Myra Breckinridge was the transsexual star of a Gore Vidal book that was made into a movie that should have been a great movie with Raquel Welch. It was a terrible movie, all right? But that is really true. My voice is the voice of a transsexual. This is absolutely true, okay? But nevertheless, I believe, and that's why I've called my book, okay, Free Women, Free Men, that it's time to valorize, okay, the sexes. Transgender people in the middle, okay, actually gain identity from the existence of the mass of men and the mass of women. Okay. So I applaud you as a man. Okay.
Thank you so much for being bold and going into the non-PC realm and empowers people like me. I sort of grew up a Baptist Taliban, if you will, and I made the jump to libertarianism. And I would just like to ask you, And from my perspective, libertarianism is about empowerment. It is the party the women should be migrating to, in my opinion.
Yeah.
In your opinion, how do we draw more women to the libertarian philosophy and explain to them that it is the party of empowerment, whereas the Democrat, progressive, the idea is sort of to replace men with the government, whereas the libertarian philosophy is to empower women and while also empowering men. So
yes.
How would we do that?
Yes, I do call myself a libertarian as well, even though I'm not really part of the Libertarian Party at all. But yes, I think this is really true. What you said exactly right. Okay, we cannot have a situation where women now substitute the government for the male figures upon which we used to depend for economic sustenance. I think we need many more, actually, parties in the United States. The problem is we have these like giant big tent parties, the two, which suck up all the oxygen and all the money and become a kind of porridge. Okay, there's no clear thing. But countries that have multiple parties, 12 or 13 parties, often are very fractured. They have to form coalitions in order to govern. So I can see the difficulty of multiple parties in a country of our size. But there's absolutely no doubt that we need tremendous, drastic reform of the present party structure, and I think it will only come from the challenge. Okay, that's why I'm trying to develop, on the Green Party too. Even though I don't necessarily agree with everything the Green Party stands for. Would you say that you, are, in terms of your economic policy as a libertarian, do you think you tend more toward conservative or capitalist or what? How do you?
I find myself to be fiscally conservative. I think that free enterprise has brought more people out of poverty than any government program, mm-hmm. and I've traveled overseas quite a bit, and I've seen that. I mm-hmm. think that we're facing a situation where we don't have free enterprise. Mm-hmm. We have burdensome regulation and taxation that's sort of suppressing small businesses and individuals to the advantage of too big to fail corporations. We bail out the banks, we kick out the home, the homeowners.
Yes.
So I would say yes, I'm fiscally conservative.
Yes, I feel that what we need in, especially in the inner city, in high school, is the teaching of entrepreneurship, to disadvantaged youth, to show them the way the system can work, and everything about the kind of thing that comfortable middle class and upper middle class young people get from their parents who know about banking and stock investment and so on. I definitely believe in a much more jobs oriented educational system, both at the high school and the college level. Okay, well, I think we are of the same mind. Okay.
Thank you so much. Keep doing what you're doing. Be the change.
Thank you. Great. Okay. All right. Very good. No more questions? Okay. All right. Well, thank you very much for coming.